All right, I have a couple of opening remarks, and then I'm going to be turning it over to Chief Gernon for a brief presentation to you. So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here today as we've gathered to explain and discuss a data reporting issue that was brought to our attention and that we are working diligently to resolve. This issue concerns the department's reporting of crime data from our Special Victims Division in both 2021 and in the year 2022 to the Uniform Crime Reporting Summary System, or what we colloquially just refer to as UCR. It was brought to our attention by local civil rights attorney Mary Hell and a local researcher that there were some issues with the number of cases that were reported for these years, 2021 and 2022, versus the number of actual cases that were investigated. After taking their information seriously and reviewing their information, it was determined that there were, in fact, some issues with the reporting of the data. I do want to stress to you that this issue is only in the reporting of the data. It does not affect or change the actual investigations during these years, nor does it change how any evidence in the cases was or are being handled. Our investigative and support bureau, our Performance Standards and Accountability Bureau, after being made aware of the issue, diagnosed the root cause and are currently working to address it. This is what a good police department does. We listen to the concerns of the community. We address any issues that are brought to our attention, and we publicly will own our failures and correct them. Now, I'll hand it over to Deputy Superintendent Nicholas Gernon, who will lead our Performance Standards and Accountability Bureau, that's who leads it, and he will explain the situation and the steps we're taking to address the situation to make sure it never happens again. And with that, Chief Gernon, please step forward.
So thank you all for your time and for coming today. This is going to be a presentation about basically what happened, how we got to the root cause of it, and what we're doing to fix it. So we've really got to start with a little bit of history. What is the Uniform Crime Reporting Summary Reporting System? Back in 1930, the FBI kind of decided that they needed to have some uniform way of reporting what all crime looked like throughout the country. So back then, they kind of came up with this hierarchy of crime system, whereas if there was a crime that occurred or a series of crime that occurred, they would pick the highest crime in that category and they would report that. And the benefits of this system is that because it's been going on since the 1930s, you can report crime over time, you can do these comparisons. And because it's uniform, you can compare cities to cities and state to state. So that was really kind of the important part of UCR, was that it was uniform. So every state has its own laws and its own nuances within its criminal law, but this put everything into the same category so that folks can make those apples to apples comparisons. One of the important parts for the purposes of explaining what happened here is that NOPD doesn't necessarily report directly to the FBI like most agencies don't. We report to an agency called the Louisiana Commission on Law Enforcement. And the Louisiana Commission on Law Enforcement takes all of the agencies within the state that report to them, and they package up the crime statistics and report it to the FBI. And then the FBI takes that information and reports it annually every fall in a publication that they call Crime in America. So this usually happens in the fall for the preceding year. About the 1980s or so, the FBI and the folks that put this program together, the UCR program it's called, the Uniform Crime Reporting Program, started to try and address some of the gaps in the data. So for instance, hierarchical reporting means that if there's, say, a robbery and a car theft and a murder, it only gets reported as a murder. So there's some data loss there, right? Because there were other things that happened in that series of incidents. So they came up with what was called the National Incident-Based Reporting System, or NIBRS is what we'll call it. So the NIBRS program has a lot more detail than the summer reporting system and allows for nuances in crime and crime trends to kind of be examined over time. So again, it's still a uniform reporting system, but it has a lot more pieces of the puzzle to it. In 2015, after about, you know, several decades of trying to implement this, the FBI set a hard national standard that by the time you reported your 2021 crime data, you would have to do so in a NIBRS compliant manner. So not the old summary reporting system where you would just report, you know, whatever the hierarchy of crime was, numbers of rapes, numbers of robberies, numbers of murders, but you would actually use the NIBRS system, which kind of accounts for all those different crimes that occurred. Unfortunately, though, when 2021 came and ended, and it was time for agencies to submit this crime, NOPD did not have a NIBRS compliant records management system. But NOPD was not alone in this matter. Many large agencies in many cities, large and small, had trouble and challenges implementing a NIBRS compliant system. So this slide taken here from a recent article published by Jeff Asher kind of shows what the progression of NIBRS compliance agencies were in the based on the cities of size. You can also see, looking at it in another way, other agencies, both large and small, nationally and in Louisiana, also had challenges implementing NIBRS. So for instance, in 2021, this chart taken from the Marshall Project, New York and LA did not have a NIBRS compliant reporting system in 21 and 22. And then when you drill down to Louisiana on the right, New Orleans, Shreveport, Lafayette, we weren't alone in this kind of journey on how we got here, right? So the basic premise is that we, like many cities, had challenges implementing a NIBRS compliant records management system. So in early 2023, the Louisiana Commission on Law Enforcement asked the NOPD and a number of other cities that had not submitted their NIBRS compliant data to give basically the old UCR data to submit their crime stats so that we could try and understand what crime looked like in Louisiana. Because if you have several large cities throughout your state that didn't report crime data to them, then you're going to have a gap in your data. So they needed that gap to be filled. So NOPD worked to, you know, is working to get a NIBRS compliant records management system. And while we did so, we also were working to try and fill the data gap for LCLE. So we in turn turned around and gave that data to LCLE, but we did not do so with the expectation that the data would be shared for the official FBI report that's published every year. Let me explain a little bit about where the data comes from. There's basically three what I'm going to call systems of record. The first one is most of the crimes, so robberies, assaults, burglaries, thefts, things of that nature, are completed and compiled in the police department's electronic police reporting system. We call it EPR. And that's where analytics pulls most of the data from to say how many robberies were there, how many thefts were there, how many car thefts were there. There are two other specialized categories of crime that are maintained by those divisions. So the actual murder count for the city of New Orleans is kept by the homicide division, and the statistics surrounding UCR rapes are maintained by the special victims division because they're sensitive files that we don't want everybody to have access to. So restrict access to those very specialized divisions so that they can then report out their data. So in early 23, when LCLE made this request and NOPD began to compile crime stats for both 21 and 22, the NOPD's analytical division asked the Special Victims Division to provide the number of rapes which occurred in these years. And here's where the first breakdown occurred. So when detectives and investigators and investigative supervisors look at crimes, they look at the elements of the crime as defined by Louisiana law. And so Louisiana, all first, second, third degree rapes can also be classified and are always classified as fitting the definition of the parameter of a UCR rape as defined by the FBI. The definition of a UCR rape is on the right. It's basically any penetration, no matter how slight, or attempted penetration. However, there are other crimes which are investigated by the Special Victims Division that sometimes fit the UCR definition of rape and sometimes do not. Those crimes such as sexual battery, attempted sexual battery, molestation, are basically on a case-by-case basis. You have to go through and determine whether it fit the parameters as defined by the UCR guidelines. So we published, we sent that report in early 23 to LCLE, and then in late 23, the FBI publishes their kind of annual report. And then in early 24, Mary Howell and a local researcher brought us this chart. This is theirs. And they pointed out to us that the 2021 data and the 2022 data for the number of rapes that occurred in those years were very inconsistent with previous year numbers. You can see that there's a tremendous fall off in 501 for 2021, 442 for 2022. You can also see, and just kind of note on this, and a lot of you guys have reported on this, is that as NOPD's, the public's confidence in NOPD, and especially our Special Victims Division, have risen, the number of rapes rose. So look at 2012, 2013, 2014, and you can ask all the researchers this, that as people had confidence that our survivors would be treated with dignity and with respect, and that they would have their concerns of sexual violence taken seriously, they became confident to come forward to us and share their traumatic events with us so that we could properly classify and report such. So that's why you'll see that upward graph. But the last 2 years was really what these researchers, Mary Holland, this researcher, pointed out to us and started to cause us to interrogate the data. I should pause here to kind of reiterate the fact that no investigations were impacted by this data reporting error to LCLE or eventually the FBI program. The investigations and the cases are classified based on Louisiana law, and those prosecutions are governed by the existing Louisiana revised statute. The error that we discovered is really about correcting the record in the national UCR FBI program, not related to how investigations are conducted or the outcomes of those investigations. So in 2021, we reported 501 rapes to LCLE. That was because there were 501 rapes as defined by Louisiana law, first, second, third degree rape. However, when you re-examine the data and you define the parameters of what a FBI-defined UCR rape is, you find that of the 226 sexual battery cases that occurred in 2021, 149 of them also fit the parameters of what's considered an UCR rape as defined by the FBI. You also find that of the 138 indecent behavior or molestation cases that occurred in 2021, 46 of those fit the parameter of what the FBI would consider a rape for UCR reporting purposes. So if we had done the analysis correctly in early 2023, we would have reported 696 UCR defined rapes as dictated by the FBI parameters. Remember, that's a snapshot in time. So in 2023, that's what the number stood as. Investigations continue, and we'll see that in a coming slide. Applying the same logic to 2022, we reported 442 FBI UCR rapes to the Louisiana Commission on Law Enforcement. However, when we did our re-review, we found that 232 sexual battery cases occurred, of which 175 were actually also fit the parameter of a UCR-defined rape. And of the 101 indecent behavior and molestation cases which occurred, 48 of those also fit the parameter of an FBI UCR rape. So had we done that snapshot in time in early 2023 using the parameters set by the FBI's UCR categories, we would have reported 672 FBI-defined UCR rapes. So going back to the original graph that Mary and local researcher brought us, it would have brought us more in line with historical norms, right? So we would have not seen this huge drop-off, which really caused them to think that there might have been a data error issue. So what are we doing going forward? Well, we're going to embrace transparency on this. We are doing what we're doing today, which is basically raising the public's awareness so we can correct the record publicly for both researchers, but also the public. The citizens in the community need to know what our numbers are so that they can kind of make their own determinations. Additionally, NOPD contacted LCLE, and LCLE allowed us to resubmit our sex crime statistics, and we did so over the weekend. And when we did, as we stood over the weekend, our 2021 numbers were 743, and our 2022 numbers were 726 FBI-defined UCR rapes. Remember how I said this is all a snapshot in time? Had we done it in 2023, it would have been those previous numbers. But what we decided to do was submit the numbers that we knew today are rapes, because these cases don't stop the minute they're reported. They're investigated. Investigators continue to collect evidence. Survivors get services. And, you know, as we gain evidence, we're able to better understand what occurred. And that's basically what occurred here, is why those numbers went up, is because that snapshot in time in 2023 increase to what it was this past weekend. We are also going to, in an additional spirit of transparency, start to publish quarterly reports on sex crime stats within the city of New Orleans. This is what the first quarterly report will look like, the first quarter for 2024. I will stress these are absolute raw numbers. This is the information as received at the time of report and at the close of the quarter. But we think it's important to give the public access to this raw data so that statisticians, researchers, and the public and the media can identify trends and interrogate the data to determine if there's anything going on with our data that we may not be aware of and bring it to our attention. We look at this data internally on a regular basis through our management meetings, through our MAX meetings, and we think it's important to share it with the public on a regular basis as well. We are additionally going to report a domestic violence quarterly summary each quarter. So much like we report crime stats every week, we think that it's important to kind of ensure that the public has a good trend analysis on what's going on with domestic violence statistics as well. So really at the suggestion of Ms. Howell, we're going to report both these sex crime stats and domestic violence quarterly summary reports so that outside external stakeholders can keep an eye on the statistics and determine if there's anything going forward. Again, very raw preliminary data, but it is the data that we have, and we think it's important that we share that data. We are also, in addition to this quarterly reporting, we recognize that there's a gap in how we collect the data. So very recently, the Sex Crimes Unit, the Special Victims Division, located, purchased, went through the procurement process and implemented, with the help of a grant, a sexual assault management system. And the sexual assault management system will help the sex crimes detectives manage their cases, help the sex crime supervisors manage what those detectives are doing on the cases, and also we believe it will help our statisticians translate the elements of Louisiana crimes, right? So if you have a crime, what does the law say that that crime is? And then translate the offender's behavior to what also fits perhaps a UCR definition. So in this instance, a detective will put in the elements of the crime, basically what happened, what they're investigating. And then we believe that this system will help us better report what fits UCR defined crimes such as rape, as opposed to, you know, trying to fit, make, as opposed to trying to have individual detectives make that determination. Eventually, we're also going to implement a new records management system, which is NIBRS compliant, which is really kind of the crux of one of the issues of the gaps here, is that we're moving through the procurement process for a new records management system. Again, it is important for people to understand this didn't impact the way that investigations are conducted. Our investigations are conducted by our detectives based on Louisiana law. Prosecutions are conducted based on Louisiana law. This was a statistical reporting error to the Louisiana Commission on Law Enforcement. And finally, I think it's important that we don't forget the survivors here, right? So our survivors and the people who have been through these horrible traumatic events need to know that there are services out there, that you're not alone, that if there's somebody that needs help, if there's there are resources available for survivors of sexual violence, and that you don't have to suffer alone, that you can connect to those resources, many of which you put on the screen here and which we will also share with the local media, because we want you to get the services you need so that you can help us determine, you know, so you can help move forward, so that you can help to move past some a very traumatic event. So again, we really wanted to close with the fact that our survivors can have confidence that the Sex Crimes Unit bases their investigations on Louisiana law. This statistical reporting error does not impact how those investigations are going, and that we want them to know that we're here for them, the Special Victims Division is here for them, and there are a number of other agencies, including the Health Department, STAR, Children's Advocacy Center, the Family Justice Center, that are here to connect those survivors to services. So I'll conclude just by saying that some of the references of some of the material that we posted. In the event that anybody has any questions, we'll open it up to the floor. We're going to put them in the slide that we'll actually put out in the press release later. So instead of me backing up and going back to them. Yeah. It was. Yep.
Sure. Thank you for this informative presentation. I have a question that also kind of pertains to reporting and transparency. It's in respect to the September 2020
Yeah.
Does NOPD have plans to revisit that?
Yeah, Missy, that's an excellent question. That is one of the reasons that we're going to put out this quarterly report. The quarterly report is based on kind of the old nuance system as opposed to just sexual offense, right? And NOPD recently, through the help of our communications district, switched back to a more nuanced signal coding system. So as we move forward, we're going to have better data provided. But we thought in the interim that it was important to kind of give the public that breakdown in a raw form so that statisticians and researchers can look at those trend lines. That is,
understand.
Yes, sir.
And that's obviously a major point, and I get that. So what is it that y'all are trying to, why is this such a major point that y'all want to get out to the people, though?
Yeah.
I mean, if it's just a statistical error, why is this such a big deal to the people if it doesn't really affect investigations, if it's really just small as a statistical error?
Yeah, because it's important for us to correct the record. We've made a mistake, we made an error. And we need to correct the record. We need to do so publicly so that people understand what the stats were so that we can, you know, have a better appreciation for the researchers, for the statisticians, and for the community to understand that the data that we put out is the data that we trust.
Does this impact at all the consent decree or anything?
It's a good question. Yeah, so we are obligated to be transparent and ensure that we have correct data. And so when we found this problem, let me correct that. When this problem was brought to us by community members, like when Mary Howland, this local researcher, brought us this problem, we didn't shy away from it. We worked on fixing it as opposed to running away from it. And that is a part of the consent decree, is that is your police department able to self-correct? And that's what you see here as a police department, that a member of the public brought us a problem and we worked to self-correct and fix it.
And if I may, yeah.
Snapshot, yeah, think of them as snapshots in time. So when we send in our report, it is what we know on that day. But investigations continue. So when we actually submitted reality on Easter Sunday, we uploaded our new numbers. You had a whole nother year of investigations with some of these cases. So some of the cases had been, for lack of a better term, upgraded to FBI UCR rape standards. Yeah, that's a good question. So there would be almost a modification of numbers constantly. That is why the FBI's UCR program takes it as a snapshot in time, because you have to also know, are you comparing apples to apples, right? So that's why they publish it that way. That's why they kind of set the data the way that it is, so that researchers and statisticians know that they're comparing the same time periods to the same time periods.
Rick, WGNO? I guess just one thing. I just want to clarify for myself, just to make sure, the way that
no, because Mary Holland, a local researcher, brought us that sudden dip. That graph is a graph that they brought us and said, look, there is a sudden dip here. You guys need to take a look at it. So that it was not that we saw it.
Right,
it
was that sudden dip that she noticed.
Yes, that was a statistical anomaly, yeah.
And to be clear, there has been a decrease in sex crimes, but just not that drastic?
It would be up beyond my area, right, to know whether there was a decrease or not. But I think that if you look at the data now, you'd be able to see it. You know, as you look at the data that we're releasing, and on this slide deck, it kind of has those previous year comparisons.
Okay, that sounds good. Appreciate y'all.
Thank you.
Thank you.